Today's reading comes from 1 Corinthians 5, 1 through 13. It is actually reported that there is sexual immorality among you, and a kind of that even pagans do not tolerate. A man is sleeping with his father's wife, and you are proud. Shouldn't you rather have gone into mourning and have put out of your fellowship the man who has been doing this? For my part, even though I am not physically present, I am with you in spirit. As one who is present with you in this way, I have already passed judgment in the name of our Lord Jesus on the one who has been doing this. So when you are assembled, and I am with you in spirit, and the power of the Lord Jesus is present, hand this man over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, so that his spirit may be saved on the day of the Lord. Your boasting is not good. Do you not know that a little yeast leavens a whole batch of dough? Get rid of the old yeast so that you may be new unleavened batch, as you really are. For Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed. Therefore, let us keep the festival, not with the old bread leavened with malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. I wrote to you in my letter not to associate with sexually immoral people, not at all meaning the people of this world who are immoral, or the greedy, or the swindlers, or the idolaters. In that case, you would have to leave this world. But now I am writing to you that you must not associate with anyone who claims to be a brother or a sister, but is sexually immoral or greedy or an idolater or a slanderer, a drunkard or swindler. Do not even eat with such people. What business is it of mine to judge those outside the church? Are you not to judge those inside? God will judge those outside. Expel the wicked person from them among you. Here ends the reading.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus, who is the Christ. Amen. Well, so how many of you have seen the Jerry Springer show? You know the Jerry Springer show? You've seen that? A little bit of crazy going on TV, right? Kind of wild and wacky, yeah? I mean, if you don't know that show, it is pure shock value TV. The host, Jerry Springer, would find people that just had the most bizarre and crazy things going on in their lives, and he would bring them on stage. And these are just real people. These are real people, and they would reveal these outrageous secrets to loved ones on stage. And it would erupt into fist fights and hair pulling and screaming and yelling and security guards coming out. I mean, it was utter chaos. And you would see these husbands and wives and boyfriends and girlfriends and complete families just coming unraveled, devolving into chaos on national television. And the crowd is there going, Jerry, Jerry, Jerry. And I'm thinking, are you kidding me? I mean, I watched a couple of these shows back in the 1990s, and it was unbelievable. I mean, these are real people who were tangled up in deplorable circumstances. And then after about a half an hour of pandemonium, of fisticuffs and bloody lips and wigs being thrown all over the place and people rolling around on the ground, like these folks had to get up the next morning and figure out how they're going to deal with themselves and those who are in their families, and how are they going to put their lives back together. I mean, you only needed to watch two or three of these episodes to understand just how dysfunctional and destructive human relationships can get. And then I don't know that I've watched any of those since then, but it first started airing in 1991, and I was actually surprised to find out that they just canceled the show in the summer of 2018 because of low ratings. I mean, it was on for that long. Okay, so, Pastor, why are we talking about the Jerry Springer show in church? Like, I don't get it. What is that about? Did you listen to Tony reading from 1 Corinthians 5? If you listened, you would know why we're talking about Jerry Springer, because there is a Jerry Springer show going on in the Corinthian church. Absolutely absurd. And Paul is saying, are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? If you're going to write anything down in your Bibles this morning, if you're going to keep any notes in the margin, just go to the beginning of 1 Corinthians chapter 5 and write, are you kidding me? Because that is the sediment. That is what Paul is trying to communicate to them. Are you kidding me, guys? It is actually reported, verse 1. It is actually reported. Like, this is not a secret. This is public knowledge. It is actually reported that there is sexual immorality among you, and of a kind that even the pagans do not tolerate. I mean, what is going on stage right now is immorality that is illegal in the Roman Empire. It is, you can't do it by law. And it is appalling in the Greek culture. This isn't something that's happening out in the Greek culture. This is happening in the church. And there is plenty of sexual immorality for Paul to be railing about in Corinth. I mean, that was actually what the city was best known for. Sailors would travel to Corinth just for the red light district, if you know what I mean. Like, that wasn't a secret. But Paul isn't making a commentary about the cult of Aphrodite or the followers of Aphrodite, the goddess of love and sensuality, whose temple had been erected and stood overlooking the city of Corinth as a monument. The temple of Aphrodite employed 900 to 1,000, let's just call them women of the night, to use a euphemism to keep it somewhat PG in here. But they had 1,000 workers who would offer their services in the streets of the city each evening. That is not what Paul is upset about. He's talking about what is actually happening in the Christian church, not outside in the culture. And so what's going on? I wasn't really paying attention when he read that before. What are we talking about? Well, it seems that there is public knowledge, like so public that it's gotten all the way back to Paul in Ephesus, where he's writing this letter across the bay, that there is a man in the congregation at Corinth who has fallen in love with his stepmother, his father's wife, and they're sleeping together. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? I mean, this is the definition of incest. Right here in the Bible, right here in a local church. And what Paul is really upset about, as well as what's happening between this son or lover, whatever you want to call him, and his mom or his girlfriend or whatever you want to call her. Not so much about that, but that this community, that this congregation is boasting about it. And you are proud of it, he says. I mean, this isn't even on the down low. You're proud of this. Shouldn't you have rather gone into mourning, Paul says. I mean, I'm just thinking about the Jerry Springer people. And you watch that and you're like, this is, like, scale back a little bit beyond the drama and the lights and the fist fights and the security guard and all of the ruckus going on. And so you draw back a little bit and this is tragic. What's happening in their lives? This is how people brutalize each other. This is how people ruin each people that they say they love. And I thought, well, I might as well Google it, right? Just see any, you know, loving. It happened not too many years ago in France, 2014. They passed a law that said you can marry your stepmother. Got to picture that online, but put it in the old Google, and sure enough, Jerry Springer, I want to marry my stepmother. There's a video out there. I can't show it here. It's a little crass. But Dad comes out, and he's yelling and screaming, and the son is like protesting, Dad, I can't help falling in love with, you know, how this goes. And the woman in the middle is just kind of, I mean, it is an absolute mess. But you can just hear the hurt. Shouldn't you have rather gone into mourning, Paul says. Like, this is sad. And you guys are going, Corinth, Corinth, Jerry, Jerry. Shut it off. Kick them out. Stop watching. This can't go on. It is not helpful. Put out of your fellowship, Paul says, the man who's been doing this. Now, that's pretty severe, what Paul is talking about. That is what we call excommunication, and that is a terribly painful thing. For one to be sent out of their faith community is awful, and it is only ever the very last resort, because it is the epitome of the ultimate punishment. I mean, Christian churches are to be places of grace and of love and of forgiveness for broken people. That's where we come. I mean, I have neighbors who have been excommunicated from their community of faith, and they are so hurt. They're so deeply wounded. They feel like God has thrown them out. And it was for nothing even close to sleeping with your stepmother. Excommunication is not the way to handle sin, first and foremost, in the church. But let me show you what Paul is doing, because Paul is counseling the Corinthian church to do exactly what Jesus has commanded the church to do. Jesus in Matthew 18, if you put a text in your head, Matthew 18, Jesus is speaking. He says, if your brother or sister sins, go and point out their fault, just between the two of you. If they listen to you, great, you've won them over. But if they will not listen, then take one or two others along so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses. If they still refuse to listen, tell it to the church. And if they refuse to listen even to the church, then treat them as you would a pagan or a tax collector. The point is, it doesn't have to get this far. It doesn't have to go this. Excommunication is not the first response. Let me tell you, this should have been taken care of by the men's group at Corinth. The men's group should have dealt with this at Corinth. There should have been one guy who pulled this fellow aside and said, "Are you kidding me? Like, what I'm seeing between you, that can't go on. That's not okay, man. You got to break that off, like right now." And if he doesn't listen, if that doesn't work, then a couple of guys from the men's group should have pulled this fella aside and had a cup of coffee and explained to him, "You got to drop this, man. This is not okay. You can't keep this up. No way." And it is our business to lean in on that. You're a brother. You're in our family. You can't be with your mother. And if he still doesn't break it off, yes, then the whole church should hear. And I've said this over and over again. When you do step one and step two, it almost never comes to step three. But if you omit, if you disregard, if you are unwilling to do step one or step two, it almost always comes to step three. And then you have a huge mess. And this is a huge mess in Corinth. Paul says, I've already passed judgment in verse 3. In verse 4, he says, so when you are assembled, and he's talking about a meeting of the church, a called, specific, sanctioned meeting of the whole body of Christ come together in the name of Jesus. When you get together for a meeting, if the man doesn't repent at that point, if he doesn't turn around, if he still refuses to listen, then you are to treat him like you would a pagan or a tax collector and end the relationship. But see, the point is it doesn't have to get this far. There is a step-by-step process laid out by Jesus for increasing calls to repentance. This shouldn't be a one-time guillotine. So I think the Jesus' parable of the prodigal son is instructional at this point. Some of you might know this story. Jesus tells a story about a young man, an adult son who turns to his father and says, I want my portion of the inheritance. Essentially says, Dad, everything you got, all your wealth, all your money, all of your freedom, all of the blessing, all the goodness that is of your house, when you die, I'm going to get that anyway, so essentially you're dead to me, give it to me, I want to do what I want to do with it. I want to run my life the way I want to run it. And so Jesus says the father gives it to him, and he lets him go. He says the young man goes out and he wastes it, he burns it on foolish living until it's all gone. And then he ends up in a pig pen, slopping the hogs and starving to death. And it's at this point that Jesus says he comes to his senses. At this point, he realizes that what he's doing, where he's going, how life is treating him, how things have gone since he left dad's house is not going in the right direction. Like, it is leading to death. And if he doesn't do something differently, if he doesn't turn around, if he doesn't come home, he's going to die out there. In fact, he realizes that it would be better to live under dad's house just as a servant, as a slave, if I can't come back as a son. And so he gets up, he turns around, and he starts the long journey home. And Jesus' point in the parable is that when the son comes over the hill, when the young man comes home, the father gets up and runs out of the house to collect him, to embrace him. He doesn't rail at him. He doesn't yell at him. He doesn't braid him. He doesn't beat him up. He's not in trouble. He embraces him. He gives him a shower, pulls out the nicest clothes, puts a ring on his finger, and throws a party for him. Because the son who had left, who was dead to him, is now alive again. The one who had been lost to the father is now found again. And Paul says it's like that. He says, this guy is a prodigal. Let him go. Let him go into the world. Hand this man over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, for the sinful nature, so that his spirit may be saved on the day of the Lord. That someday he may come back over the hill and come home and be embraced by the Lord. But as for now, this prodigal, let him go. Paul says, this is the Father's family. The church is God's family, and if this guy isn't going to live in the household under the Father's rules, then let him go, because he's already destroying all of the relationships around him in his family, and he will eventually destroy the relationships in the family of God in his house. It's like yeast, Paul says. Paul uses the imagery of the Jewish preparation of Passover when all the yeast was to be cleaned out of the house. It was an analogy for sin. All sin was to be discarded from life so that we could eat the Passover without it. And Paul says, get rid of the old yeast, verse 7. Get rid of the old yeast so that you may be a new unleavened batch as you really are. For Christ, the Passover lamb, has been sacrificed. Like, as the people of God, we have already been made in the family. We've already been adopted into the household. We already live at home with the Father. Jesus did that for us. In his death on the cross, we were made sons and daughters. We belong in the household. Paul says, don't bring in the old yeast. Don't bring in the old ways of life. Don't bring that into the family. You got to clean it off. You got to dust it out. Be a new batch like you already are. And then we wonder why the world looks at Christians and says we're hypocrites. Why those on the outside look in and go, they don't live like people of God. They live a whole lot like us. They just think they're so much better. They look at the church and they say they don't even deal with they call it sin, whatever is tearing apart families and ripping up relationships and ruining lives. They don't even deal with that in and amongst themselves. And so the outside world wants nothing to do with us. At least they're being honest with themselves. The church has to deal with unrepentant, openly boastful sin. Like the Jerry Springer show is always going to be in the culture. Like there will always be people living in bizarre, weird, compromising, crazy states. But it cannot, that cannot be celebrated and upholded and boasted about in the local church. Because if we are to be new people, if we are to be God's people, if we are to be set apart for the kingdom, if we are to be the test plot that the world looks at, trying to determine if it would be better to plant themselves and live under the Father's household or continue to live in their own, then we have to deal with sin that breaks it apart. And so Paul ends with this heavy-handed judgment in verse 13. Expel the wicked person from among you. And you're like, dang, that hurts, that stings. But you have to also think about that dad, that husband, the other kids in the family, about the aunt and uncle who went to the wedding and were cheering them on and are now going, brother, nephew, you, what is going on? Are you kidding me? No one ever wants it to come to this point. And it certainly doesn't have to. There are ways and places along the road for repentance and forgiveness, for mercy and for grace, even and especially for the prodigal. What we don't see in 1 Corinthians chapter 5, because in 1 Corinthians 5, Paul is severe with the people of Corinth. But Paul also knows Jesus, and he knows how repentance and forgiveness works, and he knows the importance and the responsibility of grace demanded of through the local church. And so he addresses this in his next letter. He wrote a second letter. It's called 2 Corinthians. If you want to flip over and follow me over to 2 Corinthians, it's the next book in the Bible after 1 Corinthians. If you're using the Black Pew Bible, it is 804. Turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 2. And at this point, Paul wrote this letter and then he went and visited. And he said it was a painful visit. There was tears at this. It was a hard place to be, but he got them, helped them move back on track. And he's left. And now it's about a year later, and he writes back to them. And right away in this second letter, Paul deals with this painful issue of excommunication. He says in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 6, he says, the punishment inflicted on him by the majority is sufficient. He said, we had a church meeting. We all got together. We talked about it in public. We laid it out there, and we had a vote by the church. The majority decided he's out. That's sufficient. He says now in verse 7, instead now, you ought to forgive and comfort him, so that he will not be overwhelmed by excessive sorrow. I urge you, therefore, to reaffirm your love for him. Paul says the prodigal's got to come back home. And the church has got to go out and get him. You can't leave him out there in the pig pen to die all by himself. You ought to, must, shall forgive him. You ought to, must, shall comfort him. So that he is not overwhelmed, so he's not left alone, so that the devil wouldn't have his way with him. That he wouldn't be overwhelmed by excessive sorrow. Right, to be kicked out of your faith community is the last thing anyone wants to see. But it is also the responsibility of the church to first deal with sin and then to welcome them back. We often forget that, to welcome them back, to forgive them, to comfort them, to bring them back in, so that on the day of the Lord, they may come over the hill and be embraced again by the Lord Jesus. Okay. So, here are a few things that I want you to kind of reflect on after we've sat with this Jerry Springer type text. I don't know how much of a Bible reader some of you are, or if you're new to Christianity, but you might think that this book is full of these pure as driven snow, perfectly godly, you know, stellar examples of holiness. It is not. Read it. Case in point this morning. The church has the highest density of sinners on any given Sunday morning. Christians don't have it all together. We just come in here and ask God to forgive us on the journey and help us try and a little bit get it together. Now, I have to tell you, we're preaching through, I've been working through 1 Corinthians with you, and I knew this was coming, but this would be a really easy chapter to skip, right? This would be like, I don't know if any of you, including myself, have ever heard a sermon on 1 Corinthians chapter 5, right? Some of you probably read ahead this week and went, oh my gosh, seriously? That I'm going to church this week, it's going to be Jerry Springer for sure. But here's the thing. If I were undisciplined about preaching the Word of God, I would have skipped this. Because this isn't something that anybody really wants to deal with. But listen, this is the Bible. This is the Word of God. This is the inspired Word of God given to us to both encourage and comfort us, but also to correct us. Right? We can't just have all the encouraging part. Without the correcting parts. We can't go through this and go, like it, hate it, like it, disagree with it, love it, ooh, and leave things. We can't decide what we're going to rip out and throw away and what we're going to keep. We don't stand over the Word of God and dictate to it. We sit under the Word of God and let it have its way with us. So here are three things that I want you to walk away from of 1 Corinthians 5. Number one, flee from sin. Flee from sin. If you know of sin in your life, I want you to remember you're a child of God. It doesn't belong in your life. It has no place. Walk away. Clean it out like the old yeast and be the new batch that Jesus has made you to be already. Number two, be accountable. Like it is our job as the body of Christ, as the church, to help brothers and sisters in Christ and safeguard them from going off the deep end. Like don't cheer them on. Don't stand by Jerry, Corinth, Jerry, cheering as people walk into openly blatant sin. And this is honestly the hard part of the in the up, in, and out of our faith triangle. To be in community with genuine Christians and hold each other accountable on the journey together. But it is also the most life-giving and helpful thing to be invested and keeping our brothers and sisters in Christ from crashing and burning. I mean, if the TSA calls it, I mean, why not us? If you see something, say something. And number three, and this is probably the most important, number three, welcome the prodigal home. That's our gig, man. Welcome the prodigal home. If you're here today because you're a prodigal, because at some point in your life, sin drove you away from God, you left the Father's house, but you want to come home, listen, the door is wide open. He comes out to greet you. God forgives. And if this church is anything, it is forgiving, because we know what it feels like to sin and then be forgiven. And we won't hold it over your head forever, because God doesn't hold it over your head forever. We want to reaffirm our love for you and God's love for you. You belong in this family. We aren't perfect. We never claim to be. We don't want to be. All we want to do is meet you where you are on that faith journey and love you enough not to leave you there. There's forgiveness and love in God's family. Welcome home. Amen.